gentlemen. Welcome to the Simeone Foundation Automotive Museum. My name is Rick Adams. I am the Director of Education here at the museum, and I'm standing in the middle of our exhibit, Overexposed, which showcases our two GT40s with the body panels and doors removed, and it gives us a unique perspective and look at some features of the cars we don't normally see. So you can see the bodywork to my right, as it would normally sit on the cars. We see that all the time, so we're not going to focus on that so much, but we're going to do a walkthrough of some of the features of the cars and some of the unique things that you may not draw your eye to if you come to the museum. So lots we can talk about on these cars. There's lots of neat features that we can see, but I like to start with the back of the car and the engine. And one of the things we see connected to the engine that's really kind of neat, often called the pile of snakes, are these exhaust headers in the exhaust system. So they're designed to actually distribute pressure of all the different pulsing cylinders and balance that out and spread it out evenly around the engine for reliability and performance. And you can see the idea behind the pile of snakes is actually to have these tubes all the same length and then meet together in the same spot. And they also cross over from the opposite side to balance out that pulsing pressure. So there's a lot going on with just the very simple tubing here. And it's something that's kind of cool. It's usually really hard to see with the back of the car. Even open, you don't get a very good look at it. So we get up close and personal, something that's very beautiful and well engineered and put together. Now there are other things, the luggage boxes in the back. We don't usually get a good look at those because the deck lid opens in the back and is kind of in the way. So you could see Lamar rules dictated that they had to have a certain amount of luggage space, believe it or not, in a small car like this. So they decided to put these aluminum boxes in the back. Now generally they didn't have anything in them during the race, but kind of neat view of them and perspective on seeing those. You can see some of the suspension components much better. The brake cooling ducts. So normally on top of the body, off to the side, there's a cooling duct sticking up almost like a marine porthole for venting. And that actually pulls air in. And then when you close the deck lid, it seals up on this cap and then brings air into the brake disc that we see here, this brake rotor, and helps cool that down from the extreme temperatures they would see at Le Mans. Because this car was doing 210 miles an hour and had to slow down to 30 miles an hour. So that's a pretty extreme braking event. And those brake cooling ducts helped out significantly. So something we don't normally get a good look at. The drive shafts are big. These big engines, these big 427 cubic inch engines, were putting out 450 to 500 horsepower, depending on what you read and what you believe. So that's a significant amount of power, and they had to have large components to handle that. Another thing that we see sticking up here is our oil cooler for the engine. So the engine oil would run through oil coolers on each side of the car. And there are air ducts on the side here. You can see part of it in the structure, and it would pull air in there to cool the engine to reduce the amount of heat, because horsepower is heat. So they had to cool the engines down. And it is important to note some of the differences between this is a Mark II GT40 from 1966. And in a few minutes, we're gonna look at a Mark VII or a Mark IV GT40 from 1967. So there are a lot of structural and design differences as the cars evolved. The structure, some of the bodywork that's attached to the main structure here, these rocker panels are different. The way the car is assembled is different. You'll see riveting that is different between the two cars and some of these other different panels. One other thing to note as we get to the front, you have a transmission hump here, which the engine's in the rear, but that actually is where the radiator hoses, the coolant hoses, go to the back of the car. It's a little bit different than you'll see later on. Now we're up to the front suspension. Very conventional brake cooling ducts in the front, pulling air from the sides around the radiator, which is important when we see the Mark IV GT40 later on. The very similar brake and brake caliper, which these are pretty big components for their era. They're very small compared to modern components, but large for the time. The brakes were much smaller at the time, so that's something that has evolved. Other little details, as we get to the radiator up front, you can see serial numbers that we don't normally see because the front deck lid is normally in the way. So that's kind of neat to see. They're measuring the size and capacity, and they would do actual mathematical calculations to identify how much cooling they needed, capacity, and build the radiator to that spec. Like I said, the coolant hoses come around and they actually go through that tunnel in the middle and go all the way to the back. So like I said, you'll see a difference when we see the Mark IV in a little bit. This car had provisions for two filler caps. There is a crossover system, so the gasoline is hidden in the rocker panels. That's where the gas tanks are, but you could fill it from either side, or both could be filler caps. Our car has a cap on one side that's permanent, and then you can fill it from this side, which for the exhibition, we have it zip tied shut so we can't open it, just in case visitors get a hold of that. And then you can see inside the cockpit a little bit better with the doors off, the switch gear. In this car, they're actually marked, so it's a little easier to see what all the different switch gear does. But you had to have things like turn signals and emergency brake handles. It is unique that the car's right-hand drive, but the shifters still remain on the right. This car was assembled in England. This is an Allan Mann car, so that's a little bit different compared to most street cars where they put the shifter in the center of the car. And other things, fuel pumps, normally hidden. You can see our radiator expansion tank and coolant tank is actually in the back, and the cap is back here. So there's no cap on the front of the car. The system bleeds up there. And that's a little bit of a look around our Mark II GT40. Now we're gonna head over to the Mark IV. So now we're in front of our 1967 Mark IV GT40, and I have an assistant here with me, Cecily Cairns, and she's gonna help me. We're gonna look at what makes this a GT40, quote unquote. So we're gonna check the height of the car, which is where that term comes from. So the original specification was from Ford to build a car that was 40 inches or less in height for aerodynamics and the rules at Le Mans. So let me get this nice and level here. Okay.
I'm showing just about 39 3/4 inches, so a touch under 40.
Yep, so it meets the requirement, and that's, you never know, because you can change the ride height of the car. So some of the cars spec out a little bit over that, but this car meets the requirement, so there you go, GT40. Which, as you can see, is barely up to my belt buckle. It makes a very small car, even though most people think they're large because of the large engine in the back. They're actually very tiny cars. And they were considered heavy for their time, but it's still a 2,000 pound car. It is competing against 1,700 to 1,900 pound cars, but significantly lighter than, say, a 3,700 pound current production Mustang GT. So, dramatically lighter than most street cars that we would drive, with still 450 to 500 horsepower, depending on the tune. They could change these cars mostly for Le Mans. They were detuned for reliability, but the NASCAR versions were over 500 horsepower from the same engine, so they could possibly get that out of them. And looking at this car, you can see some of the obvious differences in the construction, the way it's riveted together. The panels are different, thicker, wider. The squared off rocker panels for aerodynamic efficiency, they realized that helped the stability and the downforce on the car. The honeycomb panels, which are just like a beehive honeycomb, and you can usually tell where those are from this epoxied outer layer because they sandwich it between aluminum. And you can see those panels hidden around the car in different places, the main structural panels, like the bulkhead under the dashboard. There's one behind the driver. There's a couple in the suspension components and hidden around the front of the car. So significantly stiffer and stronger car because of that over the Mark IIs. You can see the serial number on the radiator again, another fun thing to look at. It's mentioned in a lot of books, and it's kind of alluded to in the Ford vs. Ferrari movie. Are there very unique brake ducts on this car to solve a problem of the straightaways were so long and the time between using the brakes were so long that the brakes would actually overcool. And when you use them in extreme situations, the heat would build up and actually crack the rotors and shatter them. So to avoid that, they ran the brake ducts behind the radiator, which the radiator might run between 230 and 250 degrees, and that residual warmed air would actually warm the brake system so that wouldn't happen. So a unique solution to a big problem for these cars. And something, again, with the way the deck lids open to the front, you don't get a good look at that all the time unless you peek around the corner, so it's kind of neat to see that. You can see the master cylinders for the braking system hidden behind here, the way you would fill the system. The suspension slightly different. You can see the wiper motor, and things that are much more difficult to see. Again, we have our lovely honeycombing panel. This car actually hides its fuel filler. So the fuel filler is still the same thing. The gasoline, the gas tanks are inside the rocker panels, but a little bit more slick and neat on the fuel filler system. The cockpit and doors are slightly different. This car does have roll cage, roll caging, which is unique for the time and one of the first race cars to actually worry about safety and put a separate roll cage system to protect the driver. Normally, all of the tubing would be structural to the car and weren't really worried about how it would deform or react in a crash. But this was a direct result of Ken Miles' accident. They decided to add the roll caging to the cars. So one of the first cars to feature that safety feature, which may seem strange today, but that was just commonplace in the era. The cockpit looks dramatically different on these cars. Again, the shifter is on the right of the driver, even though it's a right-hand drive car. But if you look across the cockpit above the fire suppression bottle, the red bottle there, that's actually the coolant tubes going around the left side of the car. So one important thing is they're further away from the driver, so he doesn't have to worry about warming up or being overheated from those, but just a different system of doing it. This car has a large oil tank on this side of the rocker panel there. The same basic air duct system for the rear brakes and the same basic exhaust system for the engine, so that pile of snakes still works really well and does its job. You can see some beefed up suspension components and drive shafts and things on these cars as opposed to the Mark II as the cars evolved to make them more reliable. And that's some of where the weight comes from in these cars. They're really beefed up. We often talk about the ever-changing rules at Le Mans. So in 67, they only needed one luggage compartment, and they actually moved the spare tire to the other side of the back of the car instead of hiding the spare in the front. So that took up less space. And if you look at the car when it's put together, there is an access panel to get to the spare tire more quickly instead of lifting the whole lid. So the carburation system did change dramatically on these cars, on the Mark IVs from the Mark IIs. So instead of a single four-barrel carburetor, they went to 2 4-barrel carburetors to get more air in the car, and they realized that that was something they could make more efficient and get more power. And then we have this lovely original plexiglass air box that goes over them, and actually when you close the deck lid, it seals onto the air box to 2 intakes on the outside to ram air into the engine. It's something that we actually don't normally keep on the car because of backfiring and potentially ruining the cover forever. So you can see it's a little darkened up because these engines do kind of backfire. So flames will actually come up through the carburetors when they start up, and that's just something that they do and always have done. So we don't normally get to see that part. But that's a Mark IV GT40, and that's our exhibit overexposed here at the Simeone Museum.